Well, this is the first of a new series of Northern Lights, and we'll be here every Friday until just before Easter with a look at what's happening in the wide world of the arts in the region and talking to some of the people involved. And you can get involved in the series if you want to. You might say, I can't play an instrument, I can't dance, I can't paint, but all of us can use one of these. And later on, I'll tell you about a competition involving photo booths. In there at the moment is Glenn Baxter, the cartoonist. Or is he a humorist? Or is he an artist? I'll be asking him later on, but first here's some music from a group based in Halifax who describe themselves as a radical electronic string ensemble, the Acrobats of Desire with War Games. Games by Acrobats of Desire. Now, Mick Wilson, you wrote that piece. You've been working with the group since it started. I gather they're all classically trained, and yet clearly what we heard out there wasn't classical music, and yet you couldn't say, oh, it was jazz. You couldn't say, oh, it was rock music or blues or something. Can you define the music that Acrobats of Desire play?
I think, first of all, I ought to say that although all the members of the group have been classically trained, they've nevertheless all worked in different disciplines and are far less ivory tower than you might think. As far as what the music's like, well, people always like to label things, and I don't think it's quite as simple as that. When the band were invited to perform on the regional contemporary music circuit last year, they were invited to fill the vacant radical music slot, so that's the tab, radical music, but yeah. That of course doesn't tell you a thing about what the music's really like.
Now that doesn't tell us a thing about the music, but I want you to tell us a bit more, because you can hear hints of things in there, surely. Where does that music come from?
It comes, I think, from my schizophrenic roots, in that I played in rock and roll bands for a long time, but also I've spent 6 years studying composition at York University. So that there are aspects of art music and aspects of rock music in what I'm writing for Acrobats. Mm.
Well, wouldn't it have been, though, more artistically satisfying to take a beaten path like art music, rock music, and say, I will make my contribution here? Couldn't you have just followed one of the paths?
Well, the problem here is that I find that there are serious flaws in art music and rock music. Art music is far too often inaccessible and overcomplex. Mm. Rock music in the 80s is totally bland and dead boring. I hope that Acrobats can find a path to travel that will make use of the better aspects of art music, the better aspects of rock music, to produce a sort of fusion that everyone really gets off on.
Mm. Well, there's more from Acrobats of Desire at the end of the programme. But now, for the last 60 years or so, the life and times of Fryston, a mining village near Castleford, have been captured by the amateur photographer Jack Hume. In thousands of pictures, Jack's shown the village flourishing and then dying as the pit closes down. Jack's 80 now, but he's still taking photos of the village and the community.
One day, I was walking around and I saw a chap with a tripod, three legs and a camera on, you know, with hood over, taking photographs. And I thought, I'd like to do that myself. Well, a few months later, I started work at 13 years old. I had a bit of pocket money, a shilling a week, and I saved up. And after about a month, I was going around Castleford Market, and there was a second-hand store, and there were a camera on it, a little box camera, with plates and developers to go with it, all complete for half a crown. Well, Jack bought that camera, and his first photograph was taken through a mirror of himself. And it was a good photograph.
With my eyes wide open, I'm dreaming. Can it be true? I'm holding you close to my heart.
After taking a few photographs, some of the girls used to come to me and say, Jack, how about taking this photograph? Well, I used to take quite a few of them, and I used to charge them sixpence for each one. And one day these two girls said, I bet you don't take us with us showing us knickers. I said, I bet I dare. But it was in 1930 with this, and it was supposed to be a very cheeky photograph. They were very modest in them days, you know.
Do I deserve such a break? Pinch me to prove I'm awake. I can't believe that you're really mine.
I took photographs of life in Fryston as I saw it, never thinking I were going to be brought out for an exhibition by these photographs. I took them because I loved taking photographs. That was my chief hobby. I didn't gamble, smoke, drink, or any of these habits that spend your money for you. But the camera was my best friend. Thank you. It seems a very quiet place. At one time you could hear the children laughing, joking, playing football and running around the street, but now it's just, it's nearly like being in a convent now to what it used to be. Well, seems very sad to see all these houses like they are today. After all the years I've lived in village, I've lived in Fryston 80 odd years, and I'm very, very sad to see it like it is today. Well, I don't know. Now then, ladies, I'd like you to just let me take your photo. Will you hold my stick for me?
I'd love that with this.
Come on.
Come on, girl.
Let me take you. You're in the grand set.
All ready.
There's still life in fashion.
Oh, thank you.
Christmas card
at all. Very much.
Have you got your Christmas card now?
Yes. Get down, well, Brent.
You look at me, and never mind cameras. Look at me, not cameras.
You're like that quickly.
Let that little lad wave to me.
Wave.
Hello. Oh.
Wave to him. Wave. Ta-ta.
Wave again.
Wave.
Oh, that was lovely. I got your smash in then. My gum. I'll put them in my album for Christmas. Oldest lady in Fryston.
Oh dear.
I'm going to give her a little.
Oh, lovely.
Make your day that.
That's
meant
your day.
It's
meant
my day.
Get you down.
Ah, it's smashing, is that?
Yes.
I shall be taking photographs until the day I die. Because I love it that much. It's been my big love. No, I shall go on and on while ever I can pull that trigger.
Jack Hume's photographs of Fryston are on exhibition at the Wakefield Museum until the end of the month. And there's a book of his photographs which has just been published by the Yorkshire Arts Circus. Glenn, you saw the exhibition, didn't you? Did you like it?
I did, yeah, I really enjoyed it. I've seen big exhibitions of international stars of photography like Irving Penn and Ansel Adams. And this was, you know, a breath of fresh air. Straightforward, down the road, honest, warm, affectionate. What more can I say? Go and see it.
Mm, good. Well, just to tell you that every week we're having a guest critic, and tonight it's Glenn Baxter. You might have seen his exhibitions, his gin advertisements, or even his books. And these are from Glenn Baxter's latest work, Jodhpurs in the Quantux. Wish he'd order the melon now. But more of your work later on, Glenn. But you're here as a critic, and I gather we sent you along to the theatre.
I'm afraid you did, John. I raced along to see some Shakespeare, actually. It was Henry IV, parts 1 and 2, and Henry V. Mm. And afterwards I spoke to a couple of people who have been involved in these productions.
Another king! They grow like Hydra's heads! I am the Douglas! Fatal to all those that wear those colours on them. What art thou that counterfeits the person of a king?
The king himself, who Douglas grieves at heart. So many of his shadows thou hast met, and not the very king. But seeing thou fallst on me so luckily, I will assay thee. So defend thyself.
I fear thou art another counterfeit. And yet in faith thou bearest thee like a king. But mine I'm sure thou art where thou be. And thus, I win thee!
In a funny sort of way, they seem a very good project to tour because they are kind of, how should I say, polyphonetic national plays. I mean, every area of Britain is represented in these plays in one way or another. They're very regional plays that are about the relationship between central government in London and the regions and all that. And in a funny sort of symbolic way, they seemed right for a tour. And also, they provide a group of 25 actors with a remarkably wide range of interesting work.
Oh, for a muse of fire that would ascend the brightest heaven of invention. A kingdom for a stage, princes to act, and monarchs to behold the swelling scene.
Patrick, yes. So as well as performing these three plays on different evenings, there's also an occasion when on Saturday you perform all the three plays together.
That's right.
This must be incredibly grueling for you. How do you cope with this?
There's not so many tribulations, but it's hard, it's tough, because not only do we do each play separately, but we have the midweek matinee, and then on Saturday we have the three plays, and then after that, of course, we move on to the next plays. So it is very hard, but it's very gratifying, and the audience love it.
Somebody wrote to the Arts Council and said they thought it was the most disgusting and degrading spectacle that they'd seen, but only one out of I don't know how many.
Not good enough, Michael.
No, I know, we'll have to crank things
only
up a bit.
Only one feather in your cap.
So there's been a bit of that. But really, surprisingly, I mean, what I'm calling the more conservative areas of the audience, I mean, sometimes from the quarters that you would have expected that, there's been, you know, a big welcome. Mm-hmm. So I'm afraid we've been tediously popular.
For 'tis your thoughts that now must deck our kings, carry them here and there, jumping o'er times, turning the accomplishment of many years into an hourglass. For the which supply, admit me, chorus to this history, who, prologue-like, your humble patience pray, gently to hear, kindly to judge, our play.
And the English Shakespeare Company are performing The Henrys at the Leeds Grand Theatre for a week from next Monday. Well, that's not something, Glenn, you'll need to go to because you've already seen it. But when you saw it, did you like it?
Well, John, I have to say, in all honesty, that it wasn't really my goblet of mead.